how many people have, are inside, therefore how many spaces are available. If we had that app for all of the parking downtown, we would, number one, we'd postpone building new garages for years. And number two, and far more important, all of the folks who say, oh, I don't want to go downtown because there's no place to park, would suddenly have that argument blown away. It's an easy app. One of you guys have a building.
You know, well, they've actually developed a technology, and they're using it, I believe, in Kansas City or somewhere in the United States, where they are actually things in the pavement that, as you're driving down, it'll tell you where a space is open. If you've told your phone, if you've told your phone where you're going, it'll tell you a space just opened up. Look near the front of your brewery.
That's nice.
Yeah. Well, if Varis had 100% penetration, you could just get that data out, right? Varis knows where I park.
Yeah.
I mean, I always, now they're on the beach too.
What is that?
The park by phone.
Okay,
I don't have quarters anymore. I just do that. I think, oh, and now you can use the same service on the beach. But if everybody did that, then you would say, well, it looks like space number 97 is occupied.
You know, back to the availability issue. Just made me realize something. I mean, John and I, and Gary back there, yeah, with the curly head, we came up with a business idea last year. We built a prototype, and it turned out that we didn't have the bandwidth, just said we were sending, you know, video up into the cloud to be processed. And we ended up abandoning the idea because we didn't have the bandwidth, and there were a lot of other issues, and our customers didn't have the bandwidth either, but we really didn't have it here at the hub where we were developing it. And, you know, wondering if we had the right, you know, infrastructure, would that have changed? I mean, we now have another application, something that's respond for them that doesn't require as much bandwidth, but it just sort of made me think of that, like, what would have changed in that project if we had super fast speeds here in Wilmington.
Talking about a hub and the bandwidth, I don't know if there would be an initial place where you could have, like, you know, do you have to do it all the time, or could you go check ins and things? And, you know, could we have a place that could be a meeting place for people where you could have that high intensity infrastructure as a shared workspace?
I mean, if
just some,
if some one place has it, then everyone else should be able to have it. And, you know, I don't think we're not going to put everything on a hard drive, walk out of our office and drive to this other plug in and say, okay, you've got my high speed bandwidth. What's the universe?
Well, even all the cool kids running out there, you can go there and snap a couple.
All cool kids are at one space.
But what I really wanted to get back to is the My Backyard thing, because the piece about all this that really speaks to me is the idea of how can technology bring people together. And the idea of neighborhoods and building up neighborhoods, strengthening the whole identity of neighborhoods, I think is something that really helps to create place and create a sense. You know, you guys have Front Street, not every neighborhood has sort of its place where people connect. But I'm curious maybe to hear what some of the things were that you think, any observations about why it wasn't accepted, was it not homey enough?
Yeah, I mean, I wish I knew the answers to that. I mean, we've puzzled with that for a while. We tried a number of different things. We showed it to people, and we showed it to them, oh, yeah, we would definitely use that, but they just never did. There were some things that were inherently wrong that we would never be able to fix, like people would quibble over, well, you know, actually, you know, Old Wilmington is actually over here, not over here. Well, I mean, somewhere we've got to draw the line, so it's neat. We tried to overcome some of that also by letting people do their sort of dynamic neighborhood, which as a fancy way of saying you can do a radius. But even that wasn't enough. But Ian and I were talking about this, it was kind of like this, we built this great big city and there were just no people. You know, there wasn't enough activity. I mean, I think one of the things that makes Facebook work is that your neighbors are there. So it doesn't really need to have a sort of crime and news feed and whatever thing. That's enough for you. It's that interaction. And we just never really could get that.
Your use of language, you built a great big city, is interesting. I would respectfully suggest that it's impossible to build a city for a newspaper on the internet. Why do I say that? Because I think the proverb, the medium is the message. When you're sitting at your computer terminal by yourself, you're not interacting with your neighbors. I'm familiar with some of the chat rooms that certain neighborhoods had, and it is universally a race to the bottom. Who is the stupidest neighbor in the neighborhood? And contrast that with the neighborhoods that have a block party, where people have to get out of their house and interact. And so I think that, Ian, looking at your question, what is technology doing to society? I love the internet as a source of information, but as a source of building relationships and building a city, I have some concerns, to say the least.
Yep.
So, and that's just my perspective. The New Yorker did have an article about Justin Lanier, and you guys probably know a lot more about him than I do, but he is supposedly the inventor of virtual technology, or coined the phrase.
So he says.
Yeah, exactly. But he made, and of course, it's a magazine article in New York or whatever, but he, points out that the internet fosters these shallow relationships. And that's why I think that my reporter works, because it gives me information. But my backyard, gotta go outside.
I'd rather go in my real backyard.
Right.
And that's why I think it gets back to the original question, which is, why is maybe Wilmington slower on the uptake? I think also it's because obviously there's a really huge retiree, that's in the age thing, but also, we're a bunch of people that like to get outside and think we live in a beautiful place, and we like to unplug, and we're in the water and technology don't mix. That's crazy as it sounds, but it's true. It's true, and so, for myself, if you go on my LinkedIn thing, it says, come unplug with me at the beach, it's like, that's what my message is on my thing. So I think that it's not necessarily a bad thing, but I think where it starts to sort of become a negative is like what Robert and John were saying, in terms of it's actually decreasing their opportunities in business, and that sort of thing. But I agree wholeheartedly with Lawrence. I mean, I think I'm the only person under 50 years old not on Facebook, and I think
I think the most simplistic way to respond to what you are saying there's a giant chasm between being in an online forum to participating that way and, you know, going out to the beach. Again, this is simplistic, but it may be that mobile, that quite recent advances in mobile and device and social media, maybe we've actually bridged that technology. In other words,